Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the beginning of this Studium Generale season. My name is Erwin Maas. I'm an event curator for Studium Generale, Utrecht University's public platform for knowledge and reflection. I would also like to welcome those of you who are watching from home. If you have any questions or comments, please use the YouTube chat and my colleague will pass them on to me. And of course, if you like our videos, please subscribe to our channel, and I promise you there will be loads of interesting stuff this season. This is the first evening in a series of events about the legacy of the 9/11 terrorist attacks, which we organized together with the platform Contesting Governance. When we think of history, we tend to distinguish between periods. We chop up big chunks of time, and which we then call eras. Think about what Joe Biden recently said about the withdrawal of American troops from Afghanistan. He said, "This decision about Afghanistan is not just about Afghanistan, it's about ending an era of major military operations to remake other countries." And in our stories, these eras often get a clear beginning and end, a war, a revolution, a natural disaster, or a terrorist attack. And the question is, what is the meaning of these events? Are they indeed radical turning points in history, or perhaps symptoms of developments that were already taking place? And of course, the answer depends on what perspective you take. Tonight we'll be taking a historical point of view to understand where the 9/11 terrorist attacks fit in. Did the attacks mark the beginning or end of an era? And if so, how? Our speaker of tonight has hugely contributed to the academic and public understanding of terrorism and what it does to societies. She is a distinguished professor of history of international relations and global governance at Utrecht University. And her latest book is titled Radikale Verlossing, and it's a brilliant book about the motives of terrorists, what motivates them. I know that this has been a very very busy week. She's been traveling back and forth to radio and television studios, so I'm very happy that she's here tonight. So please give it up for Beatrice de Graaf.
Thank you, Erwin, for the generous introduction. Thank you for having the courage to really meet us here in public, in physical public space. And also thanks to the people at home for tuning in. And I'm also very happy to be here in person in this beautiful academic hall. So, yes, I'm going to try to give already an historical perspective on something that is still unwinding, the war on terror, because it's not completely over yet. Still, the end of this era has been announced. Erwin just quoted President Biden already, and it's the same quote that I would like to start my lecture with as well. "My fellow Americans, the war in Afghanistan is now over," Biden said. And he also said it's not just about Afghanistan, it's about ending an era. And Biden meant with this that the war on terror, the war in Afghanistan, was over. But my point in this talk will be that it's perhaps even more than that. Perhaps Biden will turn out to be a prophet of our times. Perhaps this week, last week, he was prophesying indeed the end of a far more larger era than just the era that started with 9/11, the war in Afghanistan, the war on terror. More on that larger era in a minute, but first, if we take Biden on his focused word, if the evacuation of last August signaled the end of the war on terror, can we now already start to draw the balance? What has the war on terror achieved? This week, I keep getting questions from students, journalists, colleagues with whom I'm discussing this question. And some of my colleagues are of the opinion that historians should steer clear from already contextualizing current events. And some of them even like to quote Zhou Enlai, a Chinese politician. And when he was asked in the 70s what he thought about the French Revolution, he allegedly responded, "Dear sir, that's too early to tell." Given that the French Revolution then already occurred 200 years ago, Zhou Enlai was expressing a long view of history. He tried to steer aloof from current events, and that's perhaps a good historical position. But I'm not Chinese, and I'm more impetuous. I want to know in the here and now what the significance is. So my response could be a bit more forthcoming, and I could provide a short response on the short and the mid and the long-term effects of the war on terror. Because on the short term, we can already say something about the war on terror. On the short term, the war on terror was successful. Yes, it managed to target dozens of high-ranking terrorist leaders. Dozens, hundreds of terrorist plots were unraveled in Europe, in the Netherlands, in the United States. The US Special Forces managed to kill Bin Laden in Pakistan in 2011, and morally and seriously wounding Al-Qaeda leadership and Al-Qaeda core as such. Yet, if we consider the midterm, the picture already becomes a bit blurred. If the goal was to transcend transnational jihadism, this midterm was a failure. Not only did the targeted killing of al-Zarqawi, Al-Qaeda's official in Iraq, indirectly led to the popping up of even more monstrous heads of this jihadist hydra, the war in Iraq, starting in 2003, plunged the whole area in continuing turmoil and sowed the seed for the caliphate. So, yes, Baghdadi was terminated in 2019, the caliphate as well. Baghdadi committed suicide. But we could say that for the long term, well, that remains still to be seen, but at least 20 years after that, we can say that the number of terrorist attacks and the number of terrorist groups has not subsided. The Washington-based Center for Strategic and International Studies estimated in 2018 that the number of active terrorist groups had risen to 67 again, the highest since 1980. The 80 was the previous, the left-wing revolutionary terrorist wave. And there is even a new threat looming large in our midst already, as Foreign Affairs stated this month. The war on terror, Foreign Affairs saying, has supercharged the far right. And it's the fastest growing rise of terrorism, the right-wing extremist chapter worldwide. Right-wing extremists increased, for example, in Germany with more than 10%, and also British and European police are warning that this may be the new threat. Also, still assessing the war on terror for the long run, if we would apply just war principles to the war on terror, although it was not a proper war, we could, metaphorically speaking, and also in written text declarations of the White House, it is being named a war on terror. So if we apply just war principles to this war, then we could say that the human cost and the material cost of the war vastly outweigh the initial misery that triggered the war, which is one of those principles. 800,000 people's lives are lost. Over 20 million people have been displaced by wars and terrorism. And the material costs range between $4 and $8 trillion. Billion dollars in Dutch. So the response for the mid and the long term on the question whether the war on terror was a success could be quite devastating, even taking into account all those short-term results. And that had first and foremost to do with the fact that the objectives set for the war on terror were unachievable in principle. Because it's been said before, but it's important to state again, terrorism cannot be defeated. It's a tactic wielded by the powerless. It's a recurring ploy of the underlying party in asymmetric wars. It is the theater of fear caused by lone individuals, which they resort to if no serious group or party is paying attention to them anymore. And the problem is that this tactic is constantly evolving. Terrorists are bandwagoning on new technologies. They are the early adopters profiting from every new gadget, wave, trend in the development of information and communication technologies. Moreover, all strategies relying on head-on confrontations with terrorists without sufficiently taking into account the breeding grounds of terrorism, war, chaos, bad governance, corruption, violent ideologies or religions, they will fail these theories and strategies. And indeed, all those operations under the umbrella of the war on terror, which is still ongoing as we speak, Biden terminated the war in Afghanistan, but not the war on terror as such. This has propelled the geographic spread of jihadism in Africa and Southeast Asia. Core Al-Qaeda, core IS are tactically defeated, but affiliates are spreading elsewhere into the Middle East and in other corners of the world. So in short, it's early enough to surmise that the war on terror was not a success. So was it a failure? Was it a bankruptcy? And if yes, was it the end of this particular era, the war on terror, or was it more? Was it a game changer for the Western way in dealing with terrorism? Perhaps it was. Whether Biden is right, and we are indeed seeing the end of an era, remains to be seen. But after all, the liberal ideology that underlies interventionism, that ideology as such now stands trial. And everyone feels that we are at a tipping point, not just regarding the war on terror, but regarding the Western ideology underpinning this war on terror as well. And that is why it is important to take this moment, 20 years after, take the evacuation of Afghanistan, don't immediately push ahead in new shows of force, but take a moment of reflection and go back to where it all started. Because the war on terror that was unleashed after the attacks on the World Trade Center 2001 has deep roots. And they do not lie immediately in the neoliberal 1990s, the New World Order as proclaimed by Bill Clinton. Neither do they lie in the post-war democratization period of Franklin Delano Roosevelt to make the world safe for democracy. No, they date even further back. The evacuation of Western troops out of Afghanistan perhaps does not only mark the bankruptcy of the neoliberal paradigm of invasions and nation building, but could be the fiasco of the liberal expansionism of liberal modernity as such. So not a neoliberal bankruptcy, but a liberal bankruptcy. And liberalism, as you all know, was launched in the 19th century as an intellectual and a political ideology after the earthquakes brought about by the Enlightenment, the French Revolution, Napoleon. Yes, I am an historian. I'm going to take you further back than just the 90s of the 20th century. I'm going to take you back to the early 19th century. And with increasing distance to the end of the Cold War, it transpires that not 1989, not 1945, not even 1918 are the places, are the times where the deep cart tracks of history in which we still plow ahead with our political key concepts. Maybe far more being dug during the Age of Revolutions. Both are notions of modernity, of crimes against humanity, of civilization, of the necessity to save mankind and intervene against terror were born in this age of liberal empire. And also the threat of terror, the whole world of terror, and the instrument of total war as a war against terror were also invented and coined in this era. During the French Revolution, the world got a preview of what was going to come for the following 200 years. I quote from a French parliamentarian during the French Revolution. 10 million citizens fanned by the fire of liberty, armed with their swords, reason, eloquence, ideals, might, can change the face of the world. They make the tyrants tremble on their thrones. And subsequently, on the basis of such an idealistic ideology, French terror was poured out over Europe and the world. under the banner of universalism, of freedom and moral superiority, feudal, limited wars of conquest were transformed in total wars. In ideological campaigns that went along with the military in their rucksacks to spread the values of the French Revolution and the Napoleonic Empire. In this period, the specter of terror was born as well, in practice, in discourse, and in the ways governments responded to that. In fact, we could argue that both the modern-day terrorism, the whole word terrorism, and also the war on terror are two sides of that same coin of radical and liberal modernity. So in order to move forward, we first need to go back and understand this predicament and this long pedigree of terror. As you can see, history of terrorism as discourse and category of political change started with the French Revolution. Indeed, empirically, the first references to terrorism, the word terrorism, terrorist and terror, can be found in Dutch, British, French, Belgium journals, journal articles in the years around 1780s, 1790s. Before the French Revolution, the word terror, terreur, had been part of the political vocabulary as well, but back then it had delineated something else. And Ronald Schechter has written a beautiful book about this. Terror, before the French Revolution, was the righteous, salutary, and majestic terror of God. It was the capacity of gods and princes to instill fear in their enemies. Terror was the divine power to instill awe in a subject. It was a deeply medieval and early modern concept. It was tied to the katagon of the Roman and later the Holy Roman Empire that was there to vouchsafe the world and its inhabitants against the coming of the Antichrist. Back then, secular and divine temporality were the same. And the Habsburg Emperor was the last one who considered himself this catagon against the Antichrist, Christ wielding this power of terror, which was a benevolent power. The enemies trembled, the foes fled, but you were safe in the hands of this emperor that would protect you. But since Robespierre's reign of terror, the concept of divine terror had morphed into a secularized version, the terror of the people, the tyranny of the multitude, as Burke called it. It became a political term. And what about the emperors and the kings? Well, as I said, the last Habsburg emperor, who considered himself in this fashion, he released himself from his eschatological position under the overwhelming secular force of Napoleon in 1806. So terror was now something truly secular, ideological. Terrorism, it pointed to the French revolutionary Bonapartist system of governance by power, with ideals. It could indicate fanatism, Jacobinism, despotism. In the Netherlands, talk was about Batavian terror. Terror was bloodletting, but could also be without violence. It meant the power of the people. Moreover, through the Revolutionary and the Napoleonic Wars, the semantical field of terror and terrorism became connected to chaos as well, and disorder and anarchy in the eyes of the public. People were afraid for terror, afraid for the terror of the revolutionary armies, la grande peur, afraid for the revolution itself. So there was this Janus-faced aspect to terror. There was the fear in the people that felt challenged by terror, threatened by terror, and the terror was also an instrument of progress. It was the instrument of salutary terror, salutary governments to educate the public. And educating the public also meant installing a guillotine on the Place de la Concorde, because a guillotine was a highly modern way of executing your enemy. It was not brutal, it was not mindless, it was swift and neat and clean. At least that was the way it was presented. Terror had also this Janus face that it could be wielded by non-state terrorists. It's similar in which we discuss it today. non-state terrorist groups, but it could also be wielded by the state, the reign of terror of Robespierre against the citizens. So it has this double scare. And after 1793, with the transnational spread of the scare of Robespierre's regime of terror, reports of this terror were spread and even increased and projected the range of terror beyond France, beyond Europe, throughout the corners of the world. This is a travelogue reporting on the fear of a Dutch tourist who visited a site of terrorism and wrote about this in words like this: the barbarity and the bloodthirsty fury of the Jacobins at the time went so far that one morning they guillotined 60 children of nobles from 5 to 10 years old so that their goods could be confiscated more easily. The guillotine in a market has been moved 5 times, each time overflowing the neighboring cellars of the shed, blood with earth could not wallow in. It could be a scenery describing the horrors inflicted by ISIS, but it is French revolutionary terrorists. And terror became a unifying force for collective scares, moral outrages, moral panic. And we cannot and should not forget how the French Revolution and the ongoing years of Napoleonic warfare amounted to terror in the hearts of the citizens. This is a pamphlet on a massacre committed nearby Utrecht, the terror of Woerden, by fleeing French soldiers. But this is very much an image that was engraved in the minds of the citizens. Napoleon, but even more the right-wing image, it's a slaughterhouse field. It's the fields of Leipzig. 5 million citizens were devoured by the war machinery in these 25 years. The war that spread over the globe as a pandemic and also caused pandemics in its wake. The guillotine, the bloodlands, even the bubonic pests, they were all transported by the Napoleonic troops, and huge battles were fought in the Borodino, Leipzig, Waterloo, Jaffa, along the Nile, Zaragoza, Trafalgar, and this kept the memory of Napoleonic terror alive for many generations. It's important to note that. Why? And I try to write about this, because this terror, coupled with his ideological appeal, prompted a backlash by those old-fashioned princes and kings to try to quell it. And indeed, the countries of Europe, the princes of Europe, decided to join forces in the 6th and 7th coalition to do away with the scourge of the earth, Napoleon and his Grande Armée. These were the peace treaties that marked the end of the Napoleonic Wars, the final act of Vienna in June 1815, the Quadruple Alliance and the Paris Peace Treaty. And we could say that these were treaties that are pre-echoing the NATO treaty of after the Second World War, because it was a treaty concluded for peacetime. It was not just a treaty convening and mobilizing the forces to start a war. It was a treaty for peacetime, a treaty of mutual solidarity. And an international system was created that defined security from now on as a collective obligation, referring to the geopolitical challenge to restore a balance of power and prevent someone or something like Napoleon from ever happening again. Interestingly enough, it was still a reluctant treaty. There was no Article 5, no automated interventions, no call for global liberal invasions as such. It was still feudal princes and kings who were not willing to engage in full-scale total war on their behalf. That came a couple of years later. And this is important. The terror was sort of mitigated, put back in balance by these old feudal rulers. But then the proper war on terror was started not immediately by the reactionary heads of states after 1815, but mobilized by the press, by new radical factions, by the liberalists. So there's this interesting dissonance, discord, you could even say, with the people, the radicals and liberals that were fighting for freedom in Europe, but that spread wars of colonialism, of expansion, of universalist ideas, Christian missionaries in their wake, at the same time. And again, terrorist attacks, they help in order to get a war on terror coalition from the ground. So the first terrorist attack happened in France. It was prepared in the Netherlands, which still contained Belgium at this moment. And it started with an assault on the Paris Palace, where the supreme commander of the Allies force, the kingmaker of the post-Napoleonic peace, Arthur Wellesley, the Duke of Wellington, lived during the years of the Allied occupation of France and was trying to keep things calm and orderly there. An aggrieved Jacobin from Brussels, a Bonapartist named Catillon, awaited the Duke and fired shots at him. The perpetrator missed, but people did not get that immediately, and already via optic telegraph, via newspapers, couriers, the news of the Duke's death was conveyed throughout Europe. Well, he wasn't dead, but still, it caused a major moral panic. "They did not aim at me," Wellington said, "but at our system." Police officials in Paris, the Netherlands, and England, even the Prussians helped with them, the Austrians, they turned the table to identify the radicalist perpetrators. Newspapers claimed that those reactionary princes were not on top of things. Doing nothing is not an option. And indeed, from that moment onward, a whole machinery was being assembled to fight the terror of Bonapartism, of new rounds of Napoleonic terror, better, more systematically. This is the first head of the European security police. It was a Prussian Gruner who resided in Paris, and he was tasked to collect fausse nouvelle. He had to gorge l'esprit public. He had to identify and collect information and intelligence on people that could pose a threat to the order, to the terrorist dangereux. Those information on those people should be collected. First European blacklists were dispatched. Passports were being made. You can see it to the right. And Gruner, Metternich, and some others with him, from now on, they try to transform the Allied coalition, this balanced, reluctant coalition, into a kind of a European surveillance agency that would unleash a war on terror. And the war on terror was unleashed in the 1820s. Numbers and dozens of elite radical students, ringleaders, were apprehended, perpetrators of real terrorist attacks like George Sand, the murder of Kotzebue in 1819, or Louvel, who killed the Duc de Berry in Paris in 1820, were put on the guillotine. On the mid and the long run, however, attempts to terrorize the citizens failed into compliance, and radical networks grew even in activity, mobilized their societies, and new revolutions erupted in 1813, 1848, 1870, and then ultimately in 1917. So what you see here already is terror by the government against terrorists. But this terror could not quell citizens' radicals' thirst for power, nor could it stop them to resort to terrorism once in power themselves. And the extravagancies of both types of terrorists, the terrorists themselves committed attacks, but state terror also did away with freedoms and liberties, which prompted real-time revolutions. So, back to the future. Why am I drawing so extensively tonight on this ancient period? Well, because I like history, I love these episodes, and there's far more study to be done on them, but that's not a real reason tonight. I want to point you to the deep tracks in history, to the birth of modernity, the birth of terrorism as such, which still is the paradigm we live in. And I also want to draw your attention to the liberal imperial responses to such instances of terror that also emerged in this period. Both that type of terrorism and the collective response to them were born and made in the 19th century. And what characterized that type of terror, which we still have with us today, is the fact that it mobilized national security state, it executed progress, it executed violence, carried out violence, under the pretext of progress, of permanent security, and also with autonomy and liberty as the contested issue. Napoleon wanted the whole of Europe. The terrorists also wanted a part of Europe. They want to rule a proper nation, the Poles, the Belgians, rebels in Latin America. And both the state terror propagandists and the non-state terrorists, they fought for access to new printing media. Terrorists appropriated new information and communication techniques throughout all those four waves of terrorism that came after. The anarchists used dynamites, pistols, and colorful pamphlets. Here in the midst, you find a written recipe for nitroglycerin, a bomb that I found in the Dutch National Archives. Interestingly, the Dutch military was tasked to test whether the recipe really worked, and according to the military, it didn't, so it didn't produce a real bomb. But still, it scared the police agents. A wave later, it was the anti-colonial terrorists who were early adopted of the printing press, the radio, and machine guns, again raising a theater of fear with these new gadgets. You see members of the IRA over there, again, anarchist anti-colonial newsletter, report of a bomb attack in the Netherlands in the 1920s, completely forgotten in our collective memory. We already had terrorism, not just in the 70s of the 20s, but also even earlier back. Raising this question as well, who or what are the terrorists here? Is it a Red Army faction? Is it a non-state terrorist? Or is it the state with its programs, surveillance, monitoring? This is also part of that modernity. Under the pretext of progress, combating terrorism, a state is doing away with its liberties. And as we speak today, jihadists and right-wing terrorists are also the children of the new social media revolution that coincided with 9/11. Perhaps the most important factor that predicts new waves of terrorism is not just a new ideology, but also new rounds of information communication technologies, because that really very much coincides with these big waves of terrorism. And 9/11 may be a pivot, but perhaps it's even more the social media emergence that also took place in these years. Facebook, 2001, 2003, then came Twitter, a couple of years later, Instagram, TikTok, all those outlets that help terrorists to become their own broadcasting companies. And they piggyback, they bandwagon on the wave of such technologies. So where do we stand now? Well, we now know that today's terrorists, and also historical terrorists, cannot simply be dealt with in unleashing wars of terror. We should have known that after 1815. We should have known that in the 19th century. We should know it now. 20 years after the war on terror, the threat has metastasized. There are a greater number of regimes in geographically dispersed places facing challenges of violent extremism than 20 years before. Africa has become the new battleground for jihadism in the Sahel region, in Maghreb, Somalia, Libya, Mozambique, Democratic Republic of Congo. Afghanistan, again, may turn into a playground for competing rivalrous factions from Al-Qaeda affiliates, IS affiliates, Lashkar-e-Taiba, other organizations as well. And here at home on the domestic front, polarization and fear for jihadist terrorism has sparked or has been instrumentalized to inspire new rounds of right-wing extremist terrorism. And I'm not even discussing the risk of anti-vaccination polarization or climate activism. So with all these looming threats, how should we move forward? Again, I would say by start to look back. The Revolutionary Terror and the Napoleonic War on Terror, they came to an end in 1815. And there was a brief spell of peace and quiet where things were in balance. Why? Because the concept of Europe, the peoples of Europe, they wanted balance, they wanted tranquility and order. And they realized that terrorism was perhaps not the main problem, but the overall balance of power or the imbalance of power in Europe was, and that real threats came from geopolitical imbalances with France and Napoleon as the star example since the 17th century. Yet, then, as it is now, the fear for terrorism, that masked attacker with his theatrical weaponry, was and is primordial, la grande peur. Fear, depression, anxiety, it's still there with us. Not with everyone, but amongst young people, it is, to a large extent. But the problem of such fears, how in as much they may be real, the fears for the youngs, is the biggest threat to the world is not terrorism. We all know that. It's geopolitical. It's climate change. Today's threats are posed by competing regional powers vying for supremacy. It's therefore time, again, to look back to 1850, not make the same mistakes. Not 9/11 is the problem, but our reaction to 9/11. And the way the war on terror obfuscated what was going on elsewhere in the world. To put it stronger, Libya, Iraq, Afghanistan, Somalia, they would have been better off without Western interventions, yes. And many of our war on terror efforts have also been repurposed by authoritarian states such as Egypt and Saudi Arabia, which also profited in a negative way in our perspective from that. And even our societies, I could argue, came off worse, since the war on terror also increased anti-democratic tendencies. It undermined the international, anti-national rule of law in our countries. You can see here reports on surveillance abuses. To the right is a list of all the additional penal law paragraphs, criminal law paragraphs that have been adopted and that were not all necessary, has been investigated. There you see sites of illegal rendition, torture in the heart of the West, undermined this acclaimed liberal universal superiority where the West, where America started its wars with. So, terrorism cannot be wiped out by wars on terror. It's there, it will remain there, and it can and should be dealt with precisely, chirurgically, dependent on situation, context, and type of terror. Thus, our resistance, resilience against terrorist attacks should be increased. And it has been increased. Neither Al-Qaeda nor IS were able to found an affiliate or province in Europe, and neither may have the means to stage large-scale attacks such as those in Paris in November 2015. But we have to be careful. We have to be careful that the weapons, the instruments with which we define, identify, assess, and combat terrorism do not in turn undermine, erode our societies. And what really should worry us is if the war on terror gets military again or gets overly repressive, because perhaps there is one great predictor for new terrorist campaigns and terrorist attacks. That is the question whether in a given situation, a country, a war is going on. So, wars are the best corollary to anarchy, chaos, and new rounds of collective radicalization of whole society. So unleashing new wars, even wars inspired by high moral imperatives, they correlate mostly with situations of failed states, and failed states inevitably everywhere around the world provide new fertile grounds for radicalization and terrorist groups that find ways and places and means in those exact areas to thrive and to foster. So, priorities have shifted. It shouldn't be countering terrorism, but perhaps investing in collective security again that really should engage us. Europe needs to pull itself together, as it did after 1815. And it should think harder about real threats, about the geopolitical threats that are looming large around us, about the balance of power, perhaps a new balance of power, again with Russians. It's also interesting that every peace could only be concluded with the Russians, not without the Russians. Then there is the Iranians, there's the Chinese, so it's perhaps time to reflect on that famous trick, the trick of diplomacy. Perhaps not a trick, perhaps also a capacity, a talent for balance. Balance. Not doing nothing, not doing away with all of our moral values, but looking for a balance of the design and the Zollen, the status quo and what you really wish for, and not enforce it too hard, without the liberal imperialist dimensions, without universal claims to superiority, and with a sharper eye for temperance and balance. Then we could start a new chapter in our history. Thank you very much for listening.